You are a lesbian. I mean, not necessarily, just for the sake of, I mean, you might be. You might be for the sake of this video. The year is 1988. The place? Northampton, Massachusetts. Northampton is a small city, yet extremely lesbian. It's been a lesbian haven since the 1960s, and would have an estimated population of 10 to 20% be gay or lesbian by the 1990s, though there are more lesbians than gay men. This was Lesbianville, Massachusetts. The town hosts a variety of lesbian-owned businesses, bars, restaurants, bookshops. One bookshop has been subject to a great deal of controversy recently due to the banning of erotica and kink. Legend has it that in response to that ban, some other lesbians came to the bookstore and enacted a public SM scene. Really sounds like living in Northampton was better than anything the L word had to offer. Northampton is a place for lesbians to be proud of. The city is to lesbians what San Francisco is to gay men. It's a special place. It's home. Since 1982, Northampton has hosted a brilliant gay and lesbian pride march, and you're on the committee. The committee meets one day in early 1988 to plan for the next march, business as usual, except this time, two members of the Valley Bisexual Network, a married bisexual couple, show up and make a rather strange request. They ask that the title of the march be changed to include the word bisexual, the Lesbian, Gay and Bisexual Pride March. You laugh them out. Unfortunately, there isn't time for this nonsense. We're not doing this, but maybe we'll talk about it again next year. A married couple. Clearly to them, it's all about sex. Here in Northampton, we don't even like a lesbian erotica. We're not going to change the title of the Pride March to be all about sex. The thing about these bisexual women who want inclusion is that they just don't really understand feminism and lesbian politics. The 1988 Gay and Lesbian Pride March goes on as usual, and then in October, you reconvene and hold a vote on whether to include bisexual in the title for 1989. People show up who you've never seen before. People who come just this once, then never show up again. And the vote passes in favor of the bisexuals. But bisexuals are clearly just allies to the cause and should march as allies, like straight friends and family do. They shouldn't have the word bisexual included in the title. People were already including the word bisexual informally anyway. Sexual. Doesn't that defeat the point of the movement? To put the word sexual into your pride march? These people, these bisexuals, are parasites leeching off the hard work that you've put into creating a safe feminist lesbian space for women. One of your biggest fears is that these bisexual women are gonna dismantle that space. How can you have a women-only space if bisexual women are bringing their boyfriends along? It seems strange, doesn't it, to think that LGBT was just not a thing in those days? Since Stonewall, pride marches were gay pride or gay and lesbian pride. There was a lot of tension in among the gay and lesbian communities and the bisexual and trans communities. We're all about trans allies now, but in 1973, trans activist legend Sylvia Rivera tried to give a speech at a pride event and was booed and ignored by gay men and lesbians who saw her transness as revolting. In the 1980s, when the San Francisco Bisexual Center tried to include bisexuals in AIDS education, they were ignored. These were different times when there was perceived to be a right kind of gay and a wrong kind of gay. Bisexuals and trans people were the wrong kind of gay. But in 1989, Northampton held their first ever Lesbian, Gay and Bisexual Pride March. Lesbians complained that the bisexual presence had erased lesbians from the 1989 event. Where the 1988 event had had a gay man and a lesbian as speakers, the 1989 event had only a bisexual man and a straight woman. The mostly gay and lesbian committee had chosen to prioritize the issues of bisexuality and of the gay and lesbian civil rights bill, and chosen speakers based on that. Supposedly, a lesbian speaker had canceled at the last minute, and most of the entertainers there were lesbians, but even so, it seemed to confirm many lesbian suspicions that bisexuals were taking over this lesbian space. This movement away from the lesbian identity was clearly an assault to feminism and the theory of lesbianism as the truest practice of feminism. In 1990, another vote had the name reverted to Lesbian and Gay Pride March. This time, it was the lesbians who brought back up so that the vote would be steered in the other direction. Queer Nation, an organization in favor of bisexual inclusion, applied to the city for a permit to hold a separate all-inclusive Pride March, but they were denied. Then began the newspaper wars. The internet wasn't in as wide use in those days, so where the enlightened 21st century community might have played out this debate on Twitter, in those days, the medium was the papers. Are you ready for some 20th century letter-writing sapphic drama? Bisexual invisibility. Dear gay community news, much to my regret, for the first time in 5 years, I will not be working on the steering committee for the Northampton Pride March. I would like you to know why. As you know, last year the steering committee voted to include the word bisexual in the official title. Bisexuals had been working on the march for years without official acknowledgement. A group of lesbians became quite upset about this, and I received several phone calls to that effect last year, some of which were quite verbally abusive. This year, at the first steering committee meeting, 6 women came, who had not served on the committee before, determined to get the word bisexual removed, saying that it makes them invisible. They stated that at the next meeting, they would bring as many women as needed to accomplish this goal. At our next meeting, they brought 40 women who voted out the word bisexual, and then stated that since the word bisexual was no longer in the title, a bisexual could not be on the committee, so I could no longer serve. Now I am the one who is invisible. They also stated that they certainly would never allow a bisexual to do publicity, which had been one of my duties besides coordinating peacekeeping. Last year there were 3,000 gay people and their friends marching in Northampton to celebrate our gayness and our diversity. Gay men, lesbians, bisexuals, drag queens, leather people, straight friends and allies, such as the wonderful Jean and Jim Ganaski from PFLAG. This year, the steering committee consists of 10 lesbians claiming to speak for the entire community. As a gay person, to be oppressed by the straight community is offensive. To be oppressed by members of our own community is outrageous and much more offensive. Our community gets strength from unity. Whoever oppresses one of us oppresses all of us. If you would like to express your support for the unity of our community, please come to the Unitarian Church in Northampton on March 15th at 7:30 p.m. It is on Main Street, directly next to the City Hall. Go in the side door, into the basement. Sincerely, Mickey Siegel. Visibility? Whose visibility? Dear Gay Community News, we must respond to the accusations presented by Mickey Siegel concerning the Northampton Lesbian Gay Pride March. Her letter is an inaccurate and self-serving description of crucial events. Your readers deserve to hear both sides of the story. We were among the 6 lesbians who came to the first meeting of the steering committee. We did so because we were concerned about the focus the march has been taking in past years. Last year, in addition to the inclusion of bisexual in the march title, thereby diverting a political issue into a sexual one, there was no lesbian representation among the speakers at the rally, nor were any lesbian or women's issues addressed. This, despite the fact that the great majority of participants in the march are lesbian. We were determined not to let this happen again. We attended the meeting in order to express our concerns, explain our position, and volunteer to work on the march. What we encountered was hostility and nastiness on a level for which we were completely unprepared. When we tried to explain that we felt that lesbian and gay issues were not identical to bisexual issues because bisexuals continue to enjoy heterosexual privilege, we were told we could pass if we dressed differently. Mrs. Siegel announced that she could speak for the lesbian community because I have always felt like a man in a woman's body, and so on. The horror continued At the initial meeting, the group present voted to allow the title of the march to return to the original Lesbian Gay Pride, a tradition of 7 years. Those voting in favour included one bisexual woman and one gay man. Immediately upon hearing the outcome of the vote, some of those who had been opposed claimed they hadn't understood the vote was binding. We agreed to vote again at a later meeting, 1 month later. Yes, a large number of us attended the next meeting, because a large number of us were alarmed and concerned. We postponed discussion of the new makeup of the steering committee until the following meeting. It was decided that the steering committee should be comprised of gay men and lesbians, for we realize that we must speak for ourselves and determine our own agenda. Mrs. Siegel was not present at that meeting. Never was Mrs. Siegel, or any other bisexual, told she could not serve on the publicity committee. In the following days, the wonderful Jean and Jim Ganaski from PFLAG took it upon themselves to write to at least 13 local groups informing them of how naughty those nasty lesbians had been. At no time did the wonderful Ganaskis speak to any lesbian who had been present at the meetings or show any interest in hearing the other perspective on what had happened. Yes, this year the steering committee for the march consists of lesbians. No gay men expressed an interest in being on the committee. Lesbians do not claim to speak for the community as Mrs. Siegel claims, but Mrs. Siegel does not speak for the community either. There is a difference of opinion here as to who makes up the community. For reasons we cannot comprehend, some bisexual women seem to feel they cannot create their own community, but must attach themselves to the lesbian community. For many of us, our lesbianism is a way of life, not just something we do in bed. If Mrs. Siegel and her ilk are so concerned with having their sexual minority status respected, why don't they march in the Lesbian Gay Pride March as supporters, under their own banner? We too are concerned with the unity of our community. We're also concerned with integrity and with our own identity. Sincerely, Sarah Dreyer and Liz Brooke. These letters blew up in the community and were reprinted in other newsletters, such as a Boston Bisexual Women's Network's newsletter. As the months went on, more letters were written in responding to the drama. Dreyer and Brooke asked, why can't bisexuals just start their own community? It's an interesting question. Bisexuals had been working on the steering committee already and had a part in the gay culture in Northampton, even if they didn't identify with a separate bi community. At the same time, over in Boston, there were bisexual communities. Robin Oakes, a Boston bi community leader, responded to Dreyer and Brooke's letter with the following. The authors Sarah Dreyer and Liz Brooke seem to feel that to identify as a lesbian is to make a strong political statement, while to identify as a bisexual is simply a non-political statement about a person's bed partners, and that the addition of the B word to the Northampton March last year resulted in reducing the meaning of the march from a political event to a simple statement of sexuality. Well, I maintain that self-identifying as bisexual is very much a political statement. In the same issue, Ben Power, who later transitioned but at the time identified as a lesbian, wrote in, many lesbians at the meeting spoke of their own sense of discomfort, helplessness, and exclusion from the march this year, and in past years, for a variety of reasons. One, they are lovers or friends of bisexuals. Two, they are themselves lesbians coming out as bisexuals. Three, they are lesbians who are also sadomasochists. Four, they are lesbians who also cross-dress or are transvestites. Five, they are lesbians who are coming out as having transgender or transsexual feelings. Feeling like a man in a woman's body is no horror, contrary to Miss Dreyer and Miss Brooks. It is simply a fact of life for another brave and proud group of newly emerging oppressed people. Six, they are friends of male-to-female transvestites, the talented drag queens who performed against the grain at last year's Northampton Pride Rally. Seven, they are partners or lovers of female-to-males. Eight, they are friends of gay men and straight allies who find this year's steering committee and march a hostile, oppressive environment to anyone without lesbian separatist convictions. The current dangerous trend to narrowly define who belongs in lesbian community is intolerant of our differences, which ought to be respected, and is self-destructive to the lesbian movement itself. Because we do not wish to march over the bodies of other hurt, excluded, and silenced sexual minorities for an exclusive, albeit tiny, place in the sun for lesbians in Northampton this May, the new Alexandria Lesbian Library, which has been part of the Valley Lesbian and Gay Community for 11 years, will not participate in the march with our library banner this year, for the first time ever in Northampton history. Sheelix, a woman-to-woman SM support group for lesbians and bisexual women, and many more lesbians, gay men, SMers, TVs, and TSs, will also choose to refuse the terms of this year's discriminating Northampton Lesbian Gay March. We'll hop on a community bus to diverse New York City Pride instead, and bask in the glow of a sun large and free enough to shine on us one and all. And while we're there, we'll remember with gratitude that a leather-jacketed, cross-dressed lesbian transvestite minority woman and her drag queen supporters began it all at Stonewall. Still cause for celebration today, even down Main Street, Northampton, USA. In 1990, many bisexuals boycotted the march. They didn't feel welcome anymore. The march had about 30% fewer attendees that year. Sarah Dreyer, co-author of the Anti-Bisexual Letter, gave a speech at the march where she detailed how the rhetoric of inclusion was actually a smokescreen for lesbian hating. She was met with booing and hissing from the crowd. In response to what they called a bisexual gay takeover, radical lesbians and lesbian separatists, which I guess count as two separate groups, came together to fight bisexual fascism by forming the Lesbians for Lesbians group, where they discussed such issues as male-to-female transsexuals invading lesbian spaces. They ultimately decided to hold their own separate event from Pride, surprise, surprise, the Lesbian Liberation Rally. Lesbian activist Ilana Dykwoman reportedly said at one rally that bisexual and transsexual inclusion is meant to divide and destroy us, to drive us literally out of our minds. The following year, in 1991, at the march still known exclusively as Lesbian and Gay, Sarah Dreyer gave another speech where she said, "Some of us feel that bisexuals are a part of our community because they are oppressed for their sexual choices. Some of us feel that it takes a lot more than sexual oppression to be a community." It wasn't until 1992 that the final vote would officially bring bisexual into the Pride March name, and in 1993, a year later, it was changed to include transgender. And I think it's worth keeping in mind that this only happened after the lesbian separatists had comfortably moved on from Pride to their own lesbian liberation rally. Dreyer and Brooke didn't represent all lesbians. They didn't even represent most lesbians. To lesbian separatists, the lesbian community was something strict and narrow and had no room for trans people or bisexuals, for power or Seagull. In some ways, I can see where they're coming from. Their need for distance, their desire to stand their ground against what they saw as an invasion. I see and respect the desire for lesbian-only spaces. But for Pride? A version of Pride where you can celebrate a gay man but not a woman who will date and love and marry a woman just because she's bisexual? I think the diversity among our kinds of minorities is a little too broad to draw strict lines around. And together we're far more powerful than we would be apart. But that just wasn't the mindset of lesbian separatists. Coming out as a lesbian in the 1970s, I entered a world of absolutes. I learned to invert the values of dominant society so that lesbians were valorized and heterosexuals were denigrated. And by extrapolation, lesbians were trustworthy and heterosexuals were not. Through my association with lesbian feminists, I learned to regard bisexual women not as kinky and tainted with lesbianism, but as fence sitters, dangerously untrustworthy because of their associations with men. Bisexual representation was seen not as some queer people being able to live their reality, not as a group with their own political and often feminist agenda, but as apolitical bisexual foreigners moving in on lesbian territory. In a Calendar magazine article, this was referred to as bisexual violence and compared to rape. Bisexual women were seen as inviting violent men into lesbian spaces. I think this vitriolic response to bisexual women comes from a place of self-preservation, of fear and anxiety around men. In trying to create the safest of safe spaces, many lesbians felt they needed to put up strong boundaries around who should be included. And while obviously men were out of the question, bisexual women seemed to represent a problem. If bisexual women were welcome, who is to stop their husbands? What if she has a polycule of 20 husbands and they all come to lesbian book club and mansplain the book to everyone? Bisexual women clearly lacked a commitment to lesbianism. Do you truly care about women if you are open to hypothetically expending your energy on men? You're a traitor, a double agent. Similarly, if trans women are included in lesbian safe spaces, what if trans women are secretly men? Then there's another entry point for men to invade your lesbian fortress. This, of course, ignores any possibility for cruelty and abuse among lesbians, and potentially even enables it. Treya and Brooke felt that bisexuals and trans people needed to go find their own space, start their own communities. But what they failed to recognize was that the lesbian and gay community had been ours all along. Siegel had been serving on the Pride Committee for years. Power even identified as a lesbian. And that's a very common experience for many of us, even today, that some bisexual and trans people will identify as gay first, or just blend in so as to not stand out as different. But the truth is, we've always been here. This history was our history too. Our voices were always part of the choir. The only difference is, now they can hear them. If you enjoyed this video and know anyone interested in learning more about LGBT history, feel free to share and please consider supporting me via Patreon. Also, like and subscribe if you want notifications for my next video. Hit the little bell thing and you'll get notifications. And thanks to all my patrons! A special thanks to Aaron, Choi Jerry, ES, Joel, Nina, Susie S, and Juicy Fantasy Queen Plant Hookups. If you'd like to see your name up here too, or you just want to support my videos anonymously, please check out my Patreon. You can also get some special treats there, and thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.